This
Welcome to
conference will
Journalist
now be
Underground.
recorded.
Today our chief guest Dr. Kalyan Rama sir from VBIT Hyderabad. I welcome sir for this webinar conducting by Panipal Engineering College, Chennai. Welcome sir. Hello, it is audible sir?
Yes sir, it is audible sir.
Okay. So Dr. Kalyan Rama sir is working as a professor Department of Civil Engineering VBIT. He completed his PhD from BITS Pilani Hyderabad campus. Prior to joining VBIT, he worked from BITS Pilani Hyderabad campus and VR Siddhartha Engineering College. His research interests include failure and fragmentation of concrete structures under fatigue, dynamic and impact loading, earthquake resistant design of concrete structures and performance based design on design of concrete structures. Dr. Kalyan is an affiliate member of the International Union of Laboratories and experts in construction materials, systems and structures, and a technical committee member representing India for early age cracking of concrete and alkali activated concrete for RILAM. He is also a member of International Association of Fracture Mechanics of Concrete Structures and International Association of Engineers. He is also a life member of ICA. He is also received an International Young Researcher Travel Grant from International Association of Fracture Mechanics of Concrete Structures for attending FRAMCOSEX, Fracture Mechanics of Concrete and Concrete Structures at France. He is a committee member for financing a course content of training Andhra Pradesh State Government Engineers of Roads and Buildings and Panchayat Raj. He is a reviewer for various reputed international journals like Involved Structures, Archives of Civil and Mechanical Engineering, International Journal of Nuclear Engineering and Technology, International Journal of Fatigue, Engineering Structures, Construction and Building Materials. He has delivered more than 16 invited lectures across the country at various state and central level academic and industrial organizations. He is currently guiding 3 PhD students, guided 12 master projects and more than 30 BTech projects. He is author of 13 papers in international journals, 6 book chapters, 26 papers at various national and international conferences, and 1 article in magazine. He was involved in design and proof checking of buildings and bridges at various private and government agencies. He is currently involved in material testing. He is associated with various collaborators from India, Germany, Sharjah, UK, Portugal and Chile. I warm welcome you sir. Now I hand over this session to Dr. Kalyan Rama sir. Thank you sir.
Yes sir, thank you Venkatesan sir for your warm introduction. Thank you so much for your introduction. So all the participants please be in mute such that it will be easy for me to handle the session uninterrupted. Thank you so much sir. So we are actually sorry, we are waiting for some participants, so there is a delay by 5 minutes or 8 minutes I guess. So today I'll be talking about, sir only requested to speak me on dynamic and impact loading conditions. I hope, I'll make it very simple because, the topics that I'm going to cover right now are a bit research level. At the same time, practically also it can be used. But the only thing is I'll try to Sir, can I start now? Sir, am I audible?
Sir, yes, sir, it is audible, sir, you can start, sir.
Yeah, yeah, so please see that, you know, we don't have any further interruptions.
Yeah, sure, sir, sorry for interruption, sir.
Yes, yes.
You can make it, okay, sir.
Yes, yes, okay. So, yeah, so. Okay, fine. So I'll be talking about the important aspects of how to model concrete in finite element analysis, and before going ahead, I'll also be talking about what are the various important measures that we can take to ensure that the concrete modeling becomes very easy. And I'll be talking about the basic fundamental aspects, and I will not be dealing anything which is, you know, at a higher level. So I'll keep my presentation to less than 1 hour. I'll be rushing up. So wherever it is important, I'll be spending some time. And if at all, if I feel that, you know, I need to change at some point of time, I'll be rushing through. So I hope all of you would understand that. And you can ask all the questions at the end of the session. So that would be comfortable. Yeah, so to start with, so this is the topic I'll be covering about today: damage plasticity model to simulate the dynamic and impact loads. Overall, I'll be talking about various contents that are involved in the study. To start with, we will try to understand what are all the various models that can be used. And then we will also try to understand the importance of stress strain relationships in concrete. And one more thing is application of this damage plasticity model to various plain reinforced concrete members as well as dams and bridge decks will be studied. So I hope you will all be entering into aspects of various behavior of concrete structures. So if at all, if you get any doubt, we will discuss at the end of the session. So to start with, it's important for us to understand why do we need to define the failure of concrete. So that, if you see, so this is a very important flowchart that we need to understand in order to define the failure criteria for concrete. And in order to be more careful about, you know, addressing the concrete at various levels, it is very important for us to define the various failure criteria of concrete. So as we all know, that concrete actually is a heterogeneous material. It's not homogeneous. So it is a combination of various parameters or various raw materials like cement, fine aggregate, coarse aggregate, and all those stuff. So now when we are trying to make concrete and test the concrete, it becomes very difficult if we are unable to address various issues at micro level as well as macro level. So the understanding that we need to get from the concrete failure is that, so now whatever I'm going to speak mostly will be common for any given types of concrete. But when it comes to self-compacting concrete, bacterial concrete, and alkali activated concrete, the failure phenomena will change to some extent because of the nature of construction. So I talk about it at the end of failure of those concretes as an example. But as an outline, I'll be mostly talking about plain concrete, that is the conventional concrete. More or less, similar concepts can also be extended to other types of concretes also. So for the first 15-20 minutes, I'll be talking about the basic concepts behind modeling the failure of concrete. Then we will go to the finite element formulation. So I'll not be, because the time is limited to only 1 hour, I'll not be talking about how do you need to model plain or reinforced concrete. But I'll be letting you know how to create a model such that you can simulate the failure of concrete. So that is what I'm going to highlight upon within the given time. So for the first 15-20 minutes, I'll be talking about various failure criteria, how the concrete will behave in compression, how the concrete will behave in tension, and what will happen if you try to use various raw materials in concrete. Okay, fine. So now to start with, as I said, concrete being heterogeneous in nature requires lot of understanding to assess its behavior. Most importantly, the type of raw material that you are trying to use for making concrete plays a crucial role. That means, so concrete can be made either by cement or any other supplementary cementitious materials. Coarse aggregate can be used. So nowadays there are so many replacements of coarse aggregates, and we have fine aggregate, and there are again replacements of fine aggregate like manufactured sand, crushed sand, robo sand, even slag can be used as fine aggregate if it is properly sieved or if it is properly made as per the requirements of IS 383. Now the most important parameter when it comes to the concrete is its plastic behavior. So I'll try to skip some specific parts for your understanding such that you will also be very clear. So the most important parts that are required for concrete are the compression behavior. The most important thing is the compression behavior. Concrete, by nature, it is strong in compression. Because the nature of concrete being strong in compression, it is expected that the strength that the concrete would gain at various ages will be at par with the standard values. Now, when I mean to say standard value, we have various codal provisions. So you all might be aware that there is. Yes. Okay. So participants, so please be in mute. That will be unnecessarily interrupting the session in between. Please ensure that you are in mute throughout the entire course of the presentation. Thank you. Okay. So now when we talk about the target strengths at various ages of concrete, we all know that the concrete mixed design has to happen using a core book, that is IS 10262. So when we talk about IS 10262, the old code is already over and the new code was introduced in the year 2019. So now IS 10262-2019 is available in the market in the Bureau of Indian Standards, and that is allowing the concrete grade still M80 and M100 also. So you can design the concrete for higher strengths. So that is one advantage that we have got with the new codal provisions. Now, when we talk about the higher strengths of concrete, the most important parameter would be its compression. And in order to get the compression, we always need to test the concrete for its characteristic compressive strength after 28 days. So now when we take 28 days strength, especially when you are using a cube, you have to ensure that the compression properties of concrete, that is, so how do you get the compressive strength? You will get the load. Load by area will give you the compressive strength. That is a basic level. But we are actually interested in this specific part called plasticity. So when you talk about plasticity, it is just nothing but a plot between stress versus strain. So when you plot a graph between stress versus strain, it is expected that the concrete specimen would undergo a linear increase till some point, and after some point it will come down slowly. So depending upon the type of concrete and type of loading you are applying on the specimen, this behavior is expected. If you are following a proper displacement based design or displacement based loading, you will get a very beautiful curve like this for concrete. Now, what is the sigma called? The sigma is called yield stress, and the strain is called inelastic strain. So when we talk about the yield stress and inelastic strain of concrete in compression, so that is one of the very important parameter to assess the failure of concrete. So it is very important for us that whenever we are trying to cast the concrete, we are casting it properly. If your casting is not done properly, then the desired strength after 28 days will be lost, and this kerr will break at this point. And at this point, if it breaks, you cannot completely assess the complete failure of concrete specimen under compression. So we as an individual, and whenever we are trying to do some experiments on concrete, so these are certain very important measures that we need to take care of, very importantly. So the first thing would start with the mixing. Now, so in order to assess the failure of concrete, we have actually two models. One is the plasticity model that talks about yield stress versus inelastic strain of concrete in compression as well as tension. So right now I'll be not, I will just hold on the tension part for some time, because you know tension is one of the weakest link in concrete. So I'll talk about it a bit later in a couple of minutes or 3-4 minutes. So now the other parameter is the damage part. So right now we need to introduce the damage of concrete in compression. So let us say the damage of concrete in compression is DC. So DC will correspond to the amount of damage in concrete and in compression. So that is very important stuff. Now, how do we assess the damage in compression? So we all know that. So when will we say that the concrete cube has achieved its maximum strength? We will say that at a point where the concrete cannot take any further load. So if the concrete cannot take any further load, we will say that the specimen had reached its maximum value, and beyond that it will crack into pieces and it will break. So that's what we need to understand. So in that process, we need to define the damage of concrete in compression. So how is that we do? So normally whenever we say that if a member is failing or a material is failing, we need to understand that the failure can be a maximum of 100%. So a maximum percentage failure that can be allowed is 100%. So when we say 100% of concrete failed in compression, that means a cube will break into pieces. So we need to do that. So anyways, one more important thing I wanted to say here. The important, if someone asks which is most important, stress or strain, I would say strain, because if we know strain properly at various levels of stress, it can be directly linked to the displacement. And if you know the displacement, we will get to know what is the maximum range a concrete specimen can take, is what we will get to know. Yeah. So with that basic introduction, so initially what are we doing? If you use only plasticity models, we are going to bother about yield stress versus inelastic strain. But when we are talking about damage mechanics, we are introducing a term called damage in compression. Now, what are we trying to do? We are trying to club these both. Plasticity model plus damage mechanics is equal to combined plasticity and damage. See, some of the terms, I'll make it very simple. Even though they look complicated, I'll try my best such that you'll be understanding it in an easier way, right? Yeah. So, yes. So now moving ahead. So why do we need to use the combined model? Why can't we use other models? So there are n number of models available in concrete, but I am more interested towards this because I found it to be more accurate compared to any other models. I mean, to which I have tried, but those which I have not tried, I cannot give that common statement that it cannot be used, right? Okay. So now we all know that when we study soil mechanics or geotechnical engineering, we know that there is one common phenomena to represent the failure of soil, that is the Mohr-Coulombs theory. So this is exclusively used for soil. Now, what happened? Mohr-Coulombs theory can assess the failure of soil only till some limit. So to extend the failure of soil to a beautiful nonlinear behavior, A new model was introduced by Drucker and Prager named Drucker-Prager hypothesis. So that is a failure model which can assess the nonlinear condition of concrete. So whenever we are trying to address the nonlinear nonlinear condition of soil, so people started using this model to be used for concrete also. But at some point of time, they observed that concrete, when it is trying to be modeled using Drucker-Prager hypothesis, the results are not 100% accurate. Of course, none of the results will be accurate. At least there are some issues associated with the Drucker-Prager hypothesis. That's why the theory was extended to Drucker-Prager model. So I'll show you one more thing. Let us take, for example, a cone. If you take a cone, I'm sorry, actually, you know, here it's very difficult to sketch, but I'll try my level best. So if you take a cone of this shape, you can see that the surface, this entire surface which you are seeing as a circle, is the failure surface using the Drucker-Prager theory. But what happened after that, in order to make more efficient model to assess the failure of concrete, this failure surface was, so actually the failure factor is equal to one here. I'll not be talking about the technical terms, but the failure factor is equal to one. Now, what happened at later point of time, this factor is reduced. So one is further reduced to two by three, that is 0.66. Now the entire surface of circle is reduced by two thirds throughout the entire circumference. And this two thirds failure of represented, that represents the failure, is the damaged plasticity model. I mean, in a very simple term, I said, if you have a failure surface of a factor equal to one, that is the Drucker-Prager model, and if the failure factor is reduced to 0.667, that is 2 by 3, that is concrete damage plasticity model. Why that was reduced and how it was reduced is again a separate subject. You know, it takes again 3-4 hours to speak, but that's not very important for us right now. So now with this basic introduction, I try to move forward of why exactly and what exactly is CDPM and why do we need to use it. So now if you see again, so typical behavior of concrete can be modeled using the CDP model. And as I said, it's a combination of plasticity and damage mechanics. Now I wanted you to carefully listen to these parameters. If you are aware of these parameters, which were written on the right hand side table, it is very easy to understand what exactly is the damage plasticity model. First one is called dilation angle. Now let us say, for example, if you take a cube, I'm just giving an example. Don't take it for, you know, exactly as it is. I'm just giving an example to make you understand what exactly is the dilation angle. Of course, we have to show the failure surfaces. But if you take a cube of this shape and it is completely now concrete, it's completely made up of concrete. That is how the cube is made. Now the angle of internal friction. So now when you see the cube at the outer surface, you can see the cube to be a complete homogeneous member for us as an external look. But we know that the cube has got its shape by mixing with various raw materials, and that is combinedly called as a concrete. Now the angle of internal friction that is developed inside the concrete specimen at various failure levels is the dilation angle. And for concrete, it is suggested that we have to use the values given in the right-hand side table, which are underlined here. Actually, the range is 0 to 55. To some extent, these days, people are going to 80 also. But I would rather say for concrete, I will show you some of the studies which I have carried out. So I would say for concrete, it's very important for us to use these values. So 13, 25 and 36 to 40, not comma, 36 to 40. So I hope you have understood. It's the angle of internal friction in concrete. Next, FB naught by FC naught. This is a common value. Take any type of concrete. This value is constant and is given to be 1.16. So this was obtained based on the lot of experimental investigations on various concretes, and they have found out that I know the value will be in that range, and they have fixed that value. So what is FB naught by FC naught? It is the ratio of biaxial compressive stress to the uniaxial compressive stress of concrete, right? And then we have KC. So this we have already spoken about in the previous slide. The factor that is 2/3. Okay, and then we have viscosity parameter. So normally, so viscosity in general is a term that we normally use for fluids or liquids which has capacity to flow. But here we are using the viscosity term because of the nature that it has got. So but ultimately the value is chosen as zero. So now if you wanted to understand what exactly is viscosity in simple terms, so viscosity is a parameter that would actually link to the overall analysis of the concrete specimen in finite element software, especially named Abacus. So that's what we are trying to talk about. So I'll put it in a simple term. If you see here, if I am trying to apply a load on a beam, you know, I'll also explain you what is the difference between a beam and a prism. So if I am trying to apply a load on a beam, what will happen? It will slowly start bending like this. So this is what is called as the elastic curve, and of course that is the maximum deflection also. So it slowly starts bending, and at some point of time it breaks into two pieces. Now the most important thing is, how is that you will try to apply the load? If you apply the load at a rapid pace, like at a faster pace, this specimen will break immediately after the loading starts. So there should be a gradual increase in the application of load. That's very important part. There should be a very important phenomena, that is gradual increment in the load. So now in finite element software, whenever you are trying to apply the load, you will have to define, say for example, if concrete is taking a load of 5000 newton, okay, example. So in finite element software, you need to define in such a way that I wanted the load to be applied in 100 steps. So what is 5000 by 150? So at each and every step, 50 newton load will be applied on the concrete. Let us say, for example, you have defined only 10 steps. So what will happen? Each and every step, 500 newton will be applied. So that means, depending upon how much capacity, depending upon what type of stress strain behavior you wanted to get, you need to define your steps. But ideally speaking, the suggested step size should be very small. Like you need to apply the load at very low intervals in order to ensure that you will get a very important part of stress strain curve. So I hope everyone has worked with concrete here at least once in your lab. So now if you apply the load fast, see what will happen. It will go to the maximum load and it will fall down like this. But this is not the ideal case of stress strain behavior of concrete which we are targeting for. We always wanted our concrete to behave like a small curve, and there's a gap and then come down. So this is what we are expecting. To be more precise, I'll sketch it here. So this is what we want. Actually, you can see here. So slow increase and then a slow drop down, and then see how it comes. So this is how we need to get. This is the perfect behavior. Even this is also not correct because there is a kink here. This is also this is correct to some extent because it has fallen down and suddenly there is a drop down. That's okay. That's allowed. But this and this are not at all allowed. This will happen if you are trying to apply the load fast. Okay, fine. Now flow potential eccentricity. So this is again, so I'll again define it in a simple terms. So flow potential eccentricity in a, actually that is a very big term, but to be more precise, I'll be defining it as ratio of the tensile behavior to the compressive behavior of concrete. So if the ratio of the tensile behavior to the compressive behavior of the concrete, if it is obtained, that ratio is called the flow potential eccentricity. Now, one more important thing is the tensile behavior of concrete. That's what I am trying to say to all of you. Concrete is weak in tension, and in general, I'll go to next slide and I'll talk about it. I just hold on for a minute, but see here, the next portions are damage in compression. I have already discussed in the previous slide, and another one is damage in tension. I'll be discussing it in the next slide. So this will define yield stress versus inelastic strain, that is in compression, and yield stress versus cracking strain in tension, right? Okay, these are the values that have been specified and taken from the Abacus manual. Everybody can directly make use of it with little modifications. Yeah, now I'll spend some time here. So now it is very important for us to understand the stress strain behavior of concrete, both in tension as well as compression, which I have been talking about. In the process, if you see here, in the process, yeah, so if you see in the process, you have the compressive behavior of concrete at the top. You can see here that Mr. SNK, can you mute yourself? SNK. Yeah, okay. So now if you see the inelastic strain for this concrete is defined as plastic strain versus elastic strain. So what is plastic strain? So now if you see here, the portion where this is called as unloading path. So this is loading and this is unloading. So when you talk about the unloading path, we have the tangent modulus and secant modulus coming into picture. So ultimately, we need to understand that Young's modulus E is equal to stress by strain. That's what is the equation, right? Okay. Now, Young's modulus is equal to stress by strain. And now we can write the plastic strain as, see, the plastic strain is equal to inelastic strain minus elastic strain. That's what you can see here. See, I'll be a bit boring for next 2-3 minutes, but then I'll give the essence, because you believe me or not, if you can try to understand this specific concept clearly, whatever the experimental work you do, you can immediately follow it with the finite element model, and that will help you in publishing a paper, and that will help you in giving a very good research work. Okay, fine. Now, the other important part is the plastic strain and inelastic strain. Okay. Yeah. So the inelastic strain, which we are talking about, is actually the inelastic strain, the total strain that is obtained. Okay, at a point where this specific curve is obtained, you know, that experimentally you will get it. Okay, fine. Now, yeah, just a second. Yeah, fine. Sorry. Now, see the again next part. DC by 1 minus DC is damage in compression. So, how did we get it? See very carefully. DC by 1 minus DC into stress by Young's modulus. So stress by Young's modulus is just nothing but strain, right? Which strain? Elastic strain. So this is what we are talking about. But whenever we are talking about this elastic strain, we have a factor called 1 minus DC. So when we substitute it, there is a small derivation for this. you will get the damage in compression value. Now we'll come to tension. So I'll not be explaining in detail, but this is the overall gist. So similarly in tension also we have the same behavior. So that will actually help. So that is also one of the very important part that we can address. And the tension part in concrete. So what do we do? Normally tensile strength, you will take it as 10% of compressive strength. But I would say, so this is what we have been following for some time. But I would rather say the tensile strength will be anywhere between 7 to 15% of compressive strength. So from now on, please remember this range. That is very, very important. So like that of in compression, we have also got the same results in compression. We got it in tension. The only difference is we have got cracking strain. Okay, clear. So these two are the very important curves. From now on, it is very easy for you to understand. So these are all the various research works that have been carried out on CDP. So if you see here, so lot of research works have been carried out in damage plasticity model and validation of CDP impact load and dynamic load. So I have been working on it for the last 3-4 years. So where I fortunately I tried to publish some good papers in dynamic load, and as well as very recently we have got one more paper in impact loading with one of my collaborators from Germany. So let us move forward, and now from now on it is very easy for you to understand. Yeah, because you know the mathematical part or the basic terminology part is over. So now whenever we are trying to see, always it is not possible to test all the specimens from experimental values. So that's why it is very important for us that let us take, there are some various stress strain models. Please remember that the stress strain models are available. One is the SAINS model and another one is HSU model, HSU and SAINS. So now if you take the Indian condition, if you take M40 grade concrete as per 10262, you need to target for a strength of at least 48 Newton per mm square. That is the target strength. That is FCK plus 1.65 times standard deviation. Now, but when we used SAINS curve, this is what we have developed on our own. When we used the SAINS curve, what happened there was, you know, when we tried to plot the graph between stress and strain, see the stress at this point, it is around 43. But how much we need? 48. And one more important point is, at a drop down value at the specific strain, that is the elastic strain, if you see the previous slide, see elastic strain here at this point specifically. So at this point the stress is expected to be, the curve should be having a proper drop down like this. So that also didn't happen. So what we did was, we have proposed a new methodology with some correction factors which anyone can use, such that you see here when we introduce the correction factor, the maximum stress had been reached, and at the elastic strain value also we got a proper matching between both the trend line as well as the expected value. So this was introduced based on a factor. So for all that information you can refer to my paper given at the bottom. And see one more thing here. So this is what we have done. So we have done it as per IS 456-2000 till M55 grades of concrete, and you could see here the correction factor expression is given like this. We have also done it for Eurocode. That information you can get it from paper, but as of now I gave it only for IS 456. So once if we multiply it with the correction factor of given values, you will get a proper trend. Okay, and now as I said, there's another model called HSU and HSU model. This is a fantastic model for concrete in compression. Both SAINS model as well as HSU model are a strong parameters for concrete in compression. They are very good actually. You can use as it is. This is what we got for a given 40 grade concrete. But what you could observe, this specific part is very beautiful, very beautifully plotted. And even though it is not coming down, we didn't allow because the stresses are more, but still this has got a beautiful trend. So then what we did, we have taken a prism. So I have written it as prism. I will say one more thing here. So now there are certain things that we need to understand. If the specimen size is less than 700 mm, see, listen very carefully. So this specific length I am talking about, this length should, if it is less than 700 mm, then it is considered to be prism. The reason is, see, already we took 500 mm right now. So the total is 500. And we need to leave some space for support, correct? So that is 50 and 50. So this is 50 and this is 50. How much is left? 400. So in 400, if you wanted to get the behavior of a beam, so a beam behavior is classified into three types: flexural failure, shear failure, and flexural and shear combination failure. So when we have a combination of flexural and shear failure, it is very difficult for us that, you know, we have to address certain issues of representing all the failures. So whenever you are unable to represent the failures in all the directions, then it is not possible for us to consider that as a beam. So that is why I am calling it as prism. I hope you have understood that. So therefore, it is always important for us to use it whenever we are trying to consider it as a beam, that the minimum length should be 700 mm. So this is given in the standard code books also. So they will not say how to define a beam, how to define and all. But the thing is, it is very important that we have to understand that the three different types of failures can be understood only when we have a 700 size. I hope you have got it. Fine. So now the next part which we have studied is the mesh. So this is very important in finite element analysis, mesh convergence studies. So you need to keep on increasing your mesh element size and type of element also. So here we have used quadrilateral and triangular meshes with four different types of mesh sizes and see what we got in the next slide. Displacement versus load. So we have plotted the curve for displacement versus load, and you can see that the quadrilateral elements are very much close to each other if you see the complete trend here, but there is a large variation in triangular elements. This is quadrilateral, so there is a large variation in triangular elements. So hence we have moved with the quadrilateral elements, but we have done both. And then we have carried out a study called mesh element size versus size dependent fracture energy. Okay, let me put it this way. So normally we have strain energy. So like, say for example, if you are loading any material, so area under any material, so area under any material, area under the load deflection curve will give you strain energy. So what is the strain energy? Is the amount of work done. So work done is external and the strain energy is internal. So as long as the energy is calculated within the elastic limit, it is called as strain energy. But if the energy calculated is beyond the elastic limit, then it is called fracture energy. So see, I am repeating here. So within the elastic limit, this is called strain energy or proof resilience. Beyond elastic limit, if you are trying to calculate the energy, it is called fracture energy. Now let us understand the difference between size dependent fracture energy and size independent fracture energy. So size dependent fracture energy is generally used whenever we are trying to address the behavior of concrete specimen with same with different sizes. So I'll draw a figure here. So let us assume that there are three shapes of specimen size. Okay. Yeah. If I calculate the fracture energy for all these three specimens, and if I get different values of fracture energy, then it is called size dependent fracture energy, right? Now, because the size is varying, the energy also is varying, but actually there is a problem with that. The problem is, in general, when we wanted to study the fracture energy of concrete, it is actually a material parameter, internal material parameter. So when we say that it is a material parameter, why should it change with the change in the specimen size? Like, say, for example, you take a bottle in your hand, water bottle, which is plastic. When you try to crush it, whether it is a Kinley water bottle or, you know, any other, whatever different types of waters you have got, Bisleri or whatever type of water bottle, if you crush it, it will undergo the same type of failure as a material. Now, you can buy a 1 liter bottle or a 500 ml bottle. But ultimately, if you see a 500 ml bottle and a 1 liter bottle, when you crush it with your hand, because the material behavior is same, material will fail similarly. So your fracture energy with varying material sizes should not change. Okay, so that is where we have further introduced a concept called size independent fracture energy. Okay, so I'll talk about it in the coming slides. So now, influence of north to depth ratios. So see that here, influence of north to depth ratios. So we have six different types of north to depth ratios. So what is north to depth ratio? See carefully. So this is the notch. So this is the notch. This is called A. And this entire beam depth is called capital D. We kept on increasing the notch to depth ratio from 0.1 to 0.6. And this is what we have got. Now, from 0.1 to 0.6, when you increase, definitely the failure will increase, right? So now, when the notch size is more, the failure will be more. So that's what we have done for calculating the peak load as well as the fracture energy values. And moving forward, so we found out that the quadrilateral mesh is good. And then see, this is what I wanted to highlight. Even though I'm saying the dynamic and impact, I'll be talking about it in the coming slides. I'll be finishing off with this. See, whatever the model which we proposed with my modifications, we have validated it. See, actually, size dependent fracture energy. See, actually, we took this value from Dr. Ramachandra Murthy. So he's a senior principal scientist at Structural Engineering Research Center, Taramani, Chennai. So he is one of my collaborators, and I have been associated with SERC for the last 8 years. So we have got a very good studies overall, and he is one of my collaborators, and we took experimental values from him. You can refer to his papers also. He has done tremendous research in the field of concrete fatigue, fracture, and dynamic loads. Fine. So if you see here, we have calculated size dependent fracture energy and size independent fracture energy. See what we got? So when we again, I didn't explain you how to calculate size dependent to independent fracture energy. Size dependent fracture energy to independent fracture, there is a method called boundary element method, boundary effect method. So there are some mathematical formulations. As of now, I will not be talking about it. The thing is, the other important aspect that we have got from that would be very important point. So size independent fracture energy, when we calculated using modified model and experimental value, see what we have got. We have got a very close relation between both, right? And now let us move forward quickly. Now earlier I have mentioned some various parameters that eccentricity, dilation angle, and viscosity. You all remember that, right? So now, based on that values, we have done a parametric study. Parametric study, you can use, this is what we have done. So the eccentricity value we have changed for two different values, 0.01 and 0.1. But see, we have tried these many dilation angles. These many dilation angles we have used. And for these different dilation angles, what difference did I find? Zero difference. See, that's what? Almost the difference between the maximum value and the minimum value is very less. That's fine because this is 71.6 and this is 73. So that is absolutely fine. So because of that fact, we have understood that there is no significant variation in terms of dilation angle. Then we moved ahead with various eccentricity values for two grades. One is M40, one is M20. Not major difference was found. But remember, this is one of the very important parameter. This is called characteristic length of concrete. So the characteristic length of concrete is generally calculated based on modulus of elasticity. And okay, one more thing I forgot to mention. So now if you see, G small f is size dependent fracture energy. And G capital F is size independent fracture energy. So in order to calculate the characteristic length, we want size independent fracture energy. It should not vary with size. So, and we need the tensile strength of concrete also. So now I'm going to say a statement that generally in order to represent the failure of concrete, there are two important parameters that are required. One is the tensile strength of concrete. The other one is fracture energy, that is size independent fracture energy of concrete. Okay, fine. So we have done it using both models, HSU and SINES. We have got a very good results also, size dependent, size independent and characteristic length. So finally, to validate our work, we have taken one more experimental value and see what we have got. We have got exact values of experimental thing. So experimentally, Professor Bhushan from University of Cardiff has done. He is one of the mentor for our research, and see how beautifully we are able to compare here. Both values are almost comparable. Okay, and then we also check. So earlier I said the maximum percentage of damage is 100%. So what did we do? We have varied when we converted it into a factor, it will be 1. So we have carried out various parametric studies by extending it to 1, and hardly there is no difference. So this is a negligible difference value, which is not a very important parameter. This is what we concluded also. So that's what the conclusion is. And this is how the crack got propagated. So from now on, you will be seeing the beautiful slides on some of the contour maps. Just be patient. I'll be taking, Venkatesan sir, I'll be taking another 15 minutes. Is it fine, sir?
Okay, sir. Fine, sir.
Yeah. Okay. Thank you, sir. So this is what we observed for various mesh changes. See if you have a, so this is a 0.1. So the crack size is very small, notch size. Here the notch size is large. You can play around with the mesh sizes also. And then we have a further part of, so now I'll move on to the next part. So we have carried out another very good work, which is practical in nature. We have carried out the seismic analysis, that is by applying the earthquake loads. So this is the structure that we have, these are the structures that we have taken under consideration with complete irregularity. So now I think on 25th, one of the professors will be talking about this specific part of IS-1893. So let me not talk about much in detail about it. But to be more precise, I wanted to say one thing. So mostly on 24th, I guess. Yeah. So 24th, I think Dr. Sendil will be talking about seismic analysis. But to be more precise, that's a very interesting topic. See, generally, IS-1893 Part 1 2016 has given such a beautiful definitions of how to define an irregularity in a structure. So there are different types of irregularities that can be a vertical irregularity, stiffness irregularity, strength irregularity. So now we have considered all possible irregularities as per IS-1893 Part 1. And these are the structures that we have taken. So we wanted the structure to be completely unsafe. Because this is this we have done to check the overall behavior and what are all the various methods that we can adopt later. So this was initially analyzed and designed using StatPro. And this is again, once we, and then what we done, what we have done, so this was also published in the last year in earthquakes and structures. So now if you see, we have taken a small frame out of the entire building. So modeled, this is the concrete model. And then we have got the reinforcement model also. This takes some time to analyze. Okay, we have converted into finite element part. Now see what we have done. So we have, so exclusively for gravity load, that is only dead load plus live load, we have done it for four different types of, five different grades of concrete. This is load versus deflection. So what do you mean by first failure load? So the first failure load of concrete cracking and steel yielding was observed. So whenever you are trying to load a specimen, it will crack, concrete will crack and steel will yield. So what is the first point of failure is what we have recorded in Abacus. And these are those values. And then moving ahead, see here, you can observe beautifully on the right hand side how exactly the cracks were formed on the surface of concrete at the joints as well as at the bottom. See, what we did is we have analyzed and designed the structure in zone 5. So for all of you who are, most of you are aware, but some of you who are not aware of zone 5, it is a zone where the probability of occurrence of earthquake is maximum. At the same time, if an earthquake happens, very strict measures and resistant techniques should be adopted to safeguard the structure. So that is zone 5. So now one other important part is, so in the first image, you could see the failure of concrete cracking, and the second image shows the steel yielding. And this is what we have considered, 5% damping ratio. We made it even more vulnerable by locating it in loose soil. This is intentionally done. All the cross sections of the beam and column are remaining constant, 450 by 450 mm. And accordingly, dead load, live load, and earthquake load are applied as per IS 875 part 1, part 2, and IS 1893 part 1. And this is the design. So design has been carried out based on IS 456 2000 and earthquake code IS 13920 2016. So we have designed the concrete beam and column, and this is what we have done finally, a plain concrete model and this corresponding steel reinforcement. And then if you see, we have meshed it. We have chosen an element called continuum three-dimensional eight-noded reduced integration element, and we have a truss three-dimensional element. This is one thing I wanted to highlight. Whenever you are trying to model reinforcement in concrete, in order to make the analysis very simple and time to be reduced, use truss elements for reinforcement. That will be very easy. Now, later on, we have carried out the dynamic analysis to check the natural frequency of the frame and the mode shapes corresponding to the dynamic analysis using response spectrum. But in Abacus, we have specifically got this dynamic analysis option where we can perform the frequency analysis. So these are the first six fundamental grades of concrete first six fundamental modes of vibration. And then this is what we have got. So GRDF is the gravity load design structure. EQ is earthquake load design structure. So earthquake load design structure would take the maximum load for M40 grade concrete. We have done only for M40 grade concrete. We have not done because that's not so varying grades of concrete is not an important study here, because if you do it for one grade, we'll be getting for other grades. So like that, I'll be rushing through here. Some of these results, you can get it from my paper or slides, which I'll be sharing with the organizers. First failure load, normal structure, so M40 grade. And see the failure patterns, how the crackings have been formed at beam column joints and then the column bottom. And on the extreme right, you can also see the steel yielding also. The complete steel yielding can be observed on the extreme right. So this is something very interesting. If someone is interested, you can contact me later, or you can contact Dr. Ramachandramurthy at SERC. I can give the connection to him if somebody is interested to do research there. See, normally you might all have seen, See one thing I wanted to make very clear here. I've been getting a lot of comments. It's good if you can ask questions, and I would personally feel at professional level, organizers will definitely take care of your feedback and certificates. I don't think that will be a big problem as long as you are getting good knowledge out of this program. Definitely organizers will consider your request, and please don't post questions related to feedback and certificate in the chat box. That won't look professional. So now you all might be understanding one thing, that whenever the column and beam column joints are failing, you have to do some strengthening part. So normally for strengthening, what do we use? So we use the fiber reinforced polymer, FRP, as a material to strengthen the concrete. But this SERC people, the group of scientists led by Dr. Ramachandra Murthy, have done a very good study on ultra high performance fiber reinforced concrete. So they have done the experimental part and they have shared the results with me for me to model. So this is the damage plasticity input data for ultra high performance reinforced concrete. Now you can see in the next part. So what we have done, we wanted to strengthen each and every individual element. So in order to take each and every individual element, we have taken a beam. So see, this is a proper beam size 1220. So we took a beam, and then what we have done, we have modeled the reinforcement inside it. And then this is the load versus deflection plot we have got. And finally, we have got the maximum load to be around 55-56. So see what happened now. This is how the beam cracked. Left hand side shows the beam cracking. This is because of support. This is shear failure. And this entire portion is the flexural failure. And this specific part is the flexural shear interaction failure. And you can see the red color portion on the right hand side that represents the yielding of steel. Then what we have done, we have modeled a strengthening strip, ultra high performance, and attached to the bottom of the beam. That's what you can see here. Of thickness, we changed the thickness. So that is around 10 mm, 20 mm and 30 mm. And the length is L by 3. So see what happened here. So with varying thickness, 20 mm proved to be giving very good load versus deflection value compared to the plain concrete beam. First failure load also increased. And see here, whatever the cracks you could see are, so the difference if you observe, you can see more cracks here, but what I would like to say here is this has taken more load because we have made the concrete take more load. You can see more cracks, but at the same point where the previous plain beam failed, the number of cracks are less. And then we have strengthened the frame, that is the column. We have made a tubular column to be inserted inside the frame. You can see the bottom here. So this top layer is this tube made up of ultra high performance concrete. Okay, so again, load versus deflection. So I'll be rushing through here because mostly you'll find the same results. And then we have strengthened the beam column joint, that is this specific joint. You can see this here, a tube. This tube was attached at this point very carefully. And then we have carried out analysis and we got a beautiful result. You can see here at the beam column joints, hardly you can find any cracks, very rare compared to the previous cases. Mostly the cracks are formed on the surface, but not on the internal surface of concrete. And these are the conclusions from the study. And finally, I'll be rushing through with some of the case studies. So the next thing that I'm going to show is an animation. Please see very carefully. This is what we have done, how the concrete will crack like an experimental part. So this is how in experiments also you will get a proper breaking of concrete into two pieces. We have successfully we are successfully able to simulate the exact behavior of concrete as that of experiments. And there are some more works which are carried out by other researchers. So this damage plasticity model can be also used to simulate the blast. You can create a blast load, TNT load. You can make it fall on the surface of concrete, and this is what you get. The where exactly the TNT has fallen down, that specific portion will be cracked a lot. And then we can study the dynamic fracture of concrete. I am rushing through, you know, because these are all case studies. This is a very good work. I'll show you it in detail. Impact load in the coming slides, I'll be showing it to you. This also I'll be showing it to you. But listen, see this image carefully. Here in this image, the impact load was dropped by a setup and it will fall on the slab. So this is the experimental behavior. This is the experimental behavior. And numerically also, they could simulate the exact behavior. Even we have also simulated it in the recent past, in the last 4 months back. I'll show that results to you. One can model punching shear of slab column joint using this damage plus. You can model anything in, and this is one interesting study, Koyna Dam earthquake analysis. What we have done is, one of my BTech, MTech student had done this. We have created a dam model, converted it into an abacus model, and then we have applied the ground earthquake data. So Koyna earthquake is a serious earthquake that has happened in India. At the time, the dam had damaged. Similar earthquake, we gave it. We got this data from United States Geological Survey Organization. We have given the input as earthquake load data. And this is what you can see here. See the cracks? This is what we have observed in the previous studies also. See here. Similar failures were observed in the previous studies. So we found out that whatever the model which we have done is exactly matching with the previous works also. So the model is working well. And later on, we have simulated the behavior of dam at various time intervals. Like when an earthquake is happening at various time intervals, how the cracks are formed. Initial crack and then the final at 14 seconds. And the same student, I have asked him to model a reinforced concrete bridge deck. I mean, so this is something which is challenging. He took around more than 12 to 20 hours to simulate this, run the analysis because of the various reasons like modeling, meshing, computational time, your system configuration, all those things will play a role here. Now, if you see all the specific parts, like he has modeled the footing part, he had modeled the piers, he had modeled the bearing, and he had modeled the deck slab, which is made up of concrete. So what I asked him is, if you see the bridge engineering part, you have various types of loadings. That is IRC, Indian Roads Congress has given various types of loadings named as AA tracked, AA wheeled, A wheeled, and A tracked. So we have considered AA wheel. See what he has done. So I have asked him to model deck slab I asked him to model a vehicle, but it will take a lot of time. So what we did is he had modeled the wheels of the vehicle and applied the load equivalent to the load of the vehicle here on the top of it, pressure. So in that part, so we have modeled two vehicles, one coming from this direction, another coming from another direction. So this is what we got it. One is the plain concrete deck slab and reinforced concrete deck slab with varying time, because this is an influence line. So this is like what we study as influence line diagram. In influence lines, normally it varies with time. So therefore, with a function of time, with the vehicle moving from one end to the other, for different grades of concrete, we got a beautiful result. This is what we have got. So at four different time periods, this is what we have got in terms of stress. You could not see red color because, you know, at 31st second, the system actually crashed. Because the system requires a lot of configuration for it to be analyzed. So we have stopped it at 31 seconds. Fine. Now, this is the last part of my presentation. So I've covered the fracture part, I've covered the dynamic and earthquake loads part, and then let us see the impact part. Meditation, sir. So is it fine?
Yes, sir. It's fine.
Okay, sir. Thank you, sir. Now, this is very important aspect when we talk about the impact. So when we have a missile impact, so it can penetrate into an object in various different ways. So firstly, penetration. So directly the penetrating object will be dived or moving into the panel, concrete panel. And this is the type of failure you can observe. The second thing is the cone cracking. See the cone crack? It takes the shape of a cone crack. So this was taken from again Ramachandra Murthy sir's paper, which he has written in 2010. This you all also can read. It will give a very, very good understanding of modeling concrete for impact loading and such a beautiful work sir has done. And even I took some of the inputs when I'm trying to simulate. And the third one, if you see, it's a spalling. So you can see the proximal face. So at the place where this immediately had an impact, proximal face, and this is the distal face. So this is called spalling. This is normally we see when something catches fire. And the fifth one would be, this is actually called as cracks only, but this is actually spalling. I'm sorry. So this is spalling, and this is called as cracking at proximal face and distal face. And then we have scabbing. I'll show you. We have simulated in our recent work with Germany. So this is scabbing. And this part is called perforation. You can see that entire thing is tweaked in, right? And the last part is called overall target response. So the overall target response with the simply supported both and hinged, this is what we will get. So in order to model the reinforced concrete under impact loading, there are three different ways that you can do. One is the smear crack model, another one is embedded formulation, and the third one is discrete model. So in the smear crack model, normally smearing will happen. So smearing properties means you have a concrete element separately with a concrete node, and the reinforcement is by default embedded into concrete. So you will not be separately modeling any steel. So it is assumed that steel is already inside the concrete and we will not be separately modeling steel. But in embedded formulation, you will model concrete separately with nodes as well as elements. And then what you will observe? You will observe that a steel also should be separately modeled, but the steel node and the concrete node are not combined together. Now, when we go to discrete model, which is a very important and useful model, you will ensure that the concrete node and steel node are same. See, you know what, actually, whenever you are talking about the node and all, the nodal values are very important. Depending upon the degrees of freedom of a given node, the stiffness matrix will vary. If the size of the stiffness matrix increases, simulation time increases. In the previous embedded formulation, so there are two separate nodes for steel and concrete, which means separate stiffness matrix have to be formulated and simulation time will be more. But when it comes to discrete part, it is very clearly understood that because both nodes are at the same point, it will reduce the overall time of the simulation by reducing the stiffness matrix size. So for all of your reference, I have given the list of all models that can be used for defining the failure of concrete. This is what I am more interested in, and this one of my collaborators working right now, Johnson-Holmquist model. Only concrete damage model can be added. Drucker-Prager I have already covered. Winfrith is again a very good model, but it takes some time to simulate. Because it requires some mathematical background behind it. Like that, we have various models to be considered, and accordingly, one has to use the model depending upon the requirement and ease. So this is the final work which we have done. We have simulated a plain and reinforced concrete slab for a blast loading with various sizes of impact. So we have taken, so this is the overall configuration of the blast with reinforcement. You can see the primary reinforcement and the distribution reinforcement. And here we have got something like two different types of projectile. one we have taken spherical projectile and the other one is ozile projectile. Just a second, I'm getting an important call. Just a second. Okay, sorry for that. Okay, so now we have modeled it for two different types of projectiles. So for spherical projectile and as well as ogive projectile. So when it have, so we have taken only the half part of the slab as well as the projectile. So this was cut into half exactly, and the slab is also cut into half part, and see what we have done. So when we simulated, this is what is called as scabbing, material completely removed out. This we have seen clearly in our simulation. And one of my collaborator from Germany, Dr. Ausif, he used Johnson-Holmquist model, and I have used my own developed concrete damage plasticity model. So you can see when the projectile is penetrating through the concrete slab, it just penetrates like this at various time intervals. But when I use damage plasticity model, you can see the concrete cracking is huge. There's a huge cracking of concrete. Now, this was published, and now we are trying to understand the behavior actually for our next work, which we are working on right now. And similarly, we have calculated the internal energy and the kinetic energy of the. So normally, kinetic energy is for the projectile. So with how much amount of kinetic energy projectile is hitting the object. So we have the World Trade Center blast with an aircraft. So that aircraft energy is called kinetic energy, and the building that is receiving the aircraft is called internal energy. So we have compared it. This was right now article in press. It will be getting issue and volume number soon. It's an Elsevier journal, recently accepted, couple of months back. So this is what we are trying to work on. This was not yet published. We are slowly working on various aspects. This is for a spherical projectile. For a spherical projectile, if you see the cracks, earlier I have shown you an experimental part. You can see how beautifully there are two differences here. This is a 300 mm diameter. This is 150 mm diameter projectile. With maximum projectile, you will be definitely experiencing the damage in concrete, whether it is in compression or tension. And one thing I wanted to highlight, if you wanted to see the gap that the projectile is penetrating through the slab, you need to highlight an option called, you need to select an option called element deletion technique. So that option is very important for you to actually delete the elements whenever it is struck by an impact load. So element deletion concept works here. And these are the then we have tried with varying diameters of the impact object from 100 to 300. And this is the failure stress, von Mises stress, with various velocities, with what velocity they are trying to hit the object. So for any of you who are very interested to carry out this this numerical part, so you can definitely use this damage plasticity model for a real-time live load and impact load for a frame. And right now, the problems that we faced are the mesh dependency. You can try to come out with a mesh independent methods. We are actually thinking about it. That will give you a very good understanding. And there is something called peridynamics. That is one of the top class research topic to simulate the impact behavior or crack initiation and propagation. And finally, we are also trying to look into strengthening the concrete slab when it is subjected to impact loads. So I would like to acknowledge Dr. Ramchandramurthy from SERC, Dr. Ramian Sivakumar from NIT Warangal, Professor Vasan from BITS Hyderabad, and Professor Farid from American University of Sharjah, and Dr. Ausif from University of Weimar, Germany. Mr. Shankar Ram is master student at University of California, Berkeley, and Mr. Sai Kuber is from Delft University of Technology, Netherlands. So these are my collaborators where I know I try to work on and simulate various aspects. So I would like to thank you all. And if you have any specific questions, you can post it in the chat box, or you can ask me by unmuting yourself if organizers permit.
So participants, You can have any questions, you can put in chat box, please.
So I'm getting some questions here. So I think you only asked it, sir.
Yes, sir.
The question is why triangular values are less compared to quadrilateral. Actually, they are not less, sir. They are comparable, but what we observed was crack propagation was beautiful in triangular. We could get a very good propagation behavior of concrete in triangular mesh, but we have gone with quadrilateral mesh because it is reducing a lot of our time. That's the only reason.
Yeah, it takes more time.
Yes.
Okay.
And there is one more question from you. CDP model is not available in ANSYS. It is exclusively available in Abacus or LS Diana. Which concrete grade has got good efficient value? Now that's simple, sir. With the increasing grade of concrete, you will get a better fracture energy value, and for higher grades of concrete, you will get a very good results.
Okay, sir. Okay, thank you. That's why I got a simple problem, sir.
Yeah, there's Vikas Suresh. So currently I'm working on multiple topics, one related to impact, and one related to earthquake, and one related to different types of concrete simulation. So masters, if you wanted to suggest, if you have a proper facilities for software, I would suggest you to simulate something to study the behavior of concrete under combined loading, so that you can write to me. I have given my email, and you can write to my email. We can discuss in detail. There is one more question from Mr. Jay Kumar. So I'll type my email in the chat box. You can make a note of it and take it. Yeah. So why single point load for beams instead? Yeah. So sir, actually there is no. The thing is, we can use both. We have preferably followed. Three-point loading. Normally, when we study for fracture, when we are studying for fracture, three-point bend is the best test. We cannot go for two-point loads. I understand that in finite element software that we need to go for two-point loading, but when it comes to fracture, it is strictly suggested to go with either wedge splitting or three-point bend. So three-point bend will normally give you the crack propagation part, and that will give a better understanding of the load versus deflection curve also. But other than that, whenever we are trying to study the behavior of concrete beam, reinforced concrete beam for various loadings, we have gone for 2-point loads only, such that we will be having a very good shear span condition. So I hope I have answered your question, Jay Kumar sir. Yeah, so if you have any further questions, you can ask. The analysis, yeah, Mr. Parkavi, the analysis process is getting late while I'm doing it. Is there any option to reduce simulation time and to get the completed results quickly? So it depends on, as I just now said, it depends on what elements you are using and how much step size you are giving. And you see, there are certain methodologies in Abacus where you can reduce the time by following various mathematical techniques like Newton-Raphson method or any other similar techniques. So one best suggestion is, if you are trying to simulate a huge beam slab or something like that, see whether if it is possible to simulate only half part of it, because the remaining part also will give you the same result. So I understand that it will delay. Most importantly, it requires a minimum configuration of 8 GB RAM. But apart from that, mesh dependent studies and the step size and the type of step you are choosing plays a crucial role. Sometimes we try to simulate the nonlinear analysis using dynamic explicit or implicit. That will take some time. So it depends. So type of problem, we need to decide how to reduce the time. I hope I have answered your question. If someone has,
yes, sir. Hello.
Yes.
No, sir. That is from participant set, I think, sir.
Perfect. Yes, sir.
Sir, thank you, sir, for your time. for time giving this opportunity for us for conducting this webinar successfully.
Thank you so much, sir. I would also like to thank the Department of Civil Engineering, head of the department, and the management of the Animal Hour Engineering College for giving me this opportunity to share whatever the knowledge I have got. Thank you so much, sir. Venkatesan, sir, you have been in touch with me for a long time, and hopefully this webinar series will be a grand success, and I wish the success of the program.
Thank you, sir. Thanks, sir. Thanks a lot, sir.
Yes, sir.
Thanks.
Okay, sir.
So participants, fill the feedback form for your further process of for your certificates links. So thanks for participating, all the participants from different colleges and universities. So I hope we will start by tomorrow for next section of this webinar. Thank you.
This conference will now be recorded.